200 different recipes submitted for this challenge just for the month of January, and I'm so proud of this community for really going all out with all of those awesome recipes you guys sent in. In this box, I have two remaining recipes, 10 I had picked out, and I gave them to Rachel. She picked out two of her favorites, and in this, we're going to pick the final one for this challenge. In this box holds those two recipes, along with a D20. Recipe 1, 1 through 10. Recipe 2, 11 through 20. And we're gonna let it decide our fate. It is, hey, let me just pull you guys over. 13. 11 through 20 is the winner. I don't actually know what recipe this is, so let's crack this thing open and see what the title of this recipe is. I'm not gonna show you the email. That was almost bad. The challenge is French toast, and from Sage, they had made a matcha mochi French toast. Now, I don't actually know what's involved in this because I tried not to memorize any of the recipes because there's over 200 of them. So what I need to do now is make a full prep list with what this recipe has, followed by creating my own recipe based on French toast, then go buy all of the ingredients, prep out all of the ingredients, so that way I can execute both dishes at the same time like you're in a restaurant, then present them to a couple of judges. There's only one thing left to do. Check out the merch down below.
The first thing I want to start looking at are my garnishes, and the first garnish I really want to make is my crumble for my apple pie French toast. I'm starting with around 70 grams of whole unsalted butter that is really cold, and we just want to cut that up into cubes. The other chunk of butter you're going to save for your caramel that we're going to make later. Now, to make the crumble, you do need a food processor, or you can do this by hand, but I find the food processor is super simple. Drop in 20 grams worth of light brown sugar and just a sprinkle of cinnamon. To this, we're going to add in 65 grams worth of all-purpose flour, and once you have all of your dries together, I do like to blend this just a small amount so that way all of the dries do completely incorporate. After mixing up your dry ingredients, add in all of your fresh butter, the 70 grams that you had set aside and cubed up. Once you have all of your butter incorporated, pulse this just a few times. You don't actually need to blend this completely because if you go to blend this completely, you're going to end up with a dough rather than any kind of a crumble. What you're really looking for is this grainy, sand-like texture. You will have some bigger chunks of butter, and that is totally okay. Once you have your crumble made and blended up, place this into your container of choice, and we are going to keep this cold in the fridge until we need it. Now, the next piece of mise en place I want to make is the caramel sauce, and in particular, the brown butter salted caramel sauce. Measure out 45 grams worth of unsalted butter, and another 45 grams that you're going to keep cold for later. That first batch of butter, the 45 grams you have on the stove, this is what we're going to turn into brown butter. Now, keep in mind, when you are cooking butter like this over a medium heat, you still have the chance of burning this very quickly, so do make sure you pay attention to it. It can go from melted butter to black butter very quickly. At this point is when I really should have pulled it off the stove, and I let it go too long. You can see how dark this butter ended up getting by the smoke that's coming off of it. And unfortunately, this is a waste of butter and we can't really use it for anything. You can see that there are small amounts of black burnt butter at the bottom, and that's definitely not what you want. So I did make a second batch of brown butter, which came out a lot nicer and was a lot lighter in color, and that's really what I was starting to look for. Now that I have my brown butter made, it is time to make the caramel. In a heavy bottom sauce pot, add in 200 grams worth of granulated sugar and start to heat this over a medium high heat. The sugar will start to actually melt down without any additional liquid as you get it all over the stove, making sure that you do constantly stir this so none of that sugar at the bottom starts to burn. This can burn very quickly, so do make sure you're constantly stirring this thing. After a couple of minutes over that medium high heat, you'll see that your sugar will actually start to melt down really, really nicely. Once you can't break it down any further with your spatula, just use a whisk to break down any large clumps of sugar. Once you have this beautiful sugar liquid, add in your 45 grams of cold butter directly to this and begin whisking it immediately. You want to make sure that you're constantly whisking this so the butter doesn't continue to break. It will come together as you dodge, duck, dive, and dodge all of that hot sugary goodness, and it will start to come together into this beautiful caramel. Now, at this point is when I do like to add in my brown butter. You can see that this does have some of the black, darker bits in it, but it's okay. Most of it was brown butter, so I let it pass. Continue to whisk this to make sure that it becomes completely homogeneous. Even if you don't have a tiny whisk, it will start to come together into this beautiful caramel sauce. This is when we begin to add in 120 milliliters worth of heavy cream. Now, when you add your cold heavy cream to your hot caramel base, it will steam on you, so keep that in mind. You may want to wear some oven-proof gloves just to make sure you don't burn your hands. I decided I have no feeling left in my hands, so I had no reason to wear gloves. Now, bring this back to a medium heat, making sure you're constantly whisking this, and once you're close to the end, after after about 2 minutes of cooking, add in a pinch of salt. This entire process should only take around 10 minutes worth of cooking. After you finish incorporating all of your salt and everything looks really nice, place this into a nice heat-proof container. In this case, I'm using a mason jar because they do hold up with heat really well. Just make sure you don't use any plastic. Metal might be fine, but just as long as it's not plastic, guys, come on. Make sure you get all that good out of there, and once you have, let this sit at room temperature for around an hour before you decide to place it into the refrigerator. Now that my sauce is made, we're going to make matcha mate milk. You want to start off with 65 milliliters worth of whole milk and heat this to 90 degrees Fahrenheit. Once you've heated up your milk, add in 10 grams worth of matcha powder. Yes, this is a lot of matcha powder, and yes, this can be expensive, but the flavor is worth it, trust me. Make sure you fully incorporate that matcha into your milk, making sure you make a mess all over your cutting board because matcha is expensive, like I explained, and it wouldn't be proper unless you made a mess with it. Once you've combined all that matcha into that milk, place this into your container of choice just to set to the side until we need it for the second half of this recipe. The second half of this recipe calls for 125 milliliters of heavy cream, followed by 175 milliliters of whole milk, 15 grams worth of sugar, and then bring this over to the stove until all of it dissolves. You do want to bring this up over a medium heat, making sure you do not scald this. We're going to cook this over the medium heat for around 10 minutes. After those 10 minutes, add in all of your matcha mate base, making sure you get all of that good in there because, as we explained earlier, this stuff isn't cheap. You know, use a piece of bread and wipe out the inside if you're really feeling it. Now, once you have the two parts combined, you are not Captain Planet and you do need to stir this for the next 10 minutes until it starts to thicken. This does take some time to thicken, and while it is over this medium heat, you want to make sure you're constantly stirring it. Eventually, it will thicken up to look somewhat like a sauce. Once this cools down, it does harden enough to spread onto whatever you really need, but for now, the consistency that you're looking for is nappé. Nappé basically means you can run your finger along it over the spoon or the spatula, and you'll be able to not see the two sides come back together.
I mean, look at the texture on this. This is freaking beautiful. Look at this. Oh, it's so good. Oh my God, I want to drink it.
Next up is making the ice cream base for my vanilla ice cream. First, we're going to heat up 325 milliliters worth of milk with 90 grams worth of sugar, 15 grams worth of milk powder, and 30 milliliters worth of agave syrup. I'm also adding in around 5 milliliters worth of vanilla. Bring this over to the stove and start heating this up just until you dissolve all of that sugar. You want to make sure you don't cook this any longer than that because you don't really need to cook down the milk. You're really just looking to dissolve that sugar. Give this a taste, and if it's to your liking, add in 325 milliliters worth of heavy cream, followed by 1 gram worth of xanthan gum. Remember, this is my favorite way of making ice cream base. Feel free to use a custard if you really want to by adding egg, but I like the xanthan gum. Xanthan gum is best blended up with an immersion blender or a regular stand-up blender, so make sure you do and fully incorporate that xanthan gum. Once you have that incorporated, place this into a nice large bowl, and this has to hang out in the fridge for at least 2 hours to chill out. Once it is totally chilled out, place this into your ice cream maker of choice, which this one is not my ice cream maker of choice because it is not the best ice cream maker I've used in a long time, but it will get the job done. Start spinning this for around 15 to 20 minutes and really just hope for the best.
Now, the easiest way to tell if your ice cream is actually finished is instead of looking at the inside and seeing the consistency, is you'll be able to smell the motor burning.
After you've filled the kitchen with the smell of burning motors, remove the ice cream from its base, making sure you do try to scrape as much as possible out of the ice cream base. Now, the problem with my ice cream maker is that it leaves these giant clumps of ice cream without fully incorporating it into the base, but as long as you give it a nice swirl, it should freeze nicely. Place a piece of parchment right over the top of it and then throw a lid on this guy. This has to freeze overnight, so yes, this is a 2-day recipe, but we're just gonna keep going and pretend it's not. Now, my apple pie filling is going to consist of 1 Gala apple and 1 Cosmic Crisp apple along with some lemon and some cinnamon. Now, this is going to be slightly different than a traditional apple pie because what I want to actually do is have it be that apple pie filling you find really at like a McDonald's apple pie fritter. So dice up your apples into these really nice small dice. You don't want to do slices for this because I feel like it would lose a lot of its texture when we go to saute this. Since this is going to be sauteed rather than really just fully baked, you want to make sure you have these nice chunky pieces of apple. And since I forgot to hit record when I had added all of my spices in, I am sauteing this over a medium heat with no oil or anything. Then we added a touch of cinnamon, 30 grams worth of brown sugar, followed by 25 grams worth of regular sugar, and then gave this a nice toss until you got these apples to be al dente. The reason why we want them to be al dente is because we do want a small amount of crunch in the middle of those apples and they're not totally soft all the way through. Once you have the texture to your liking, hit this with a squeeze of lemon, making sure that it goes all over the place, and give this a nice toss to fully fully incorporate all of that lemon juice. This is when we hit it with around 15 grams of unsalted butter. Give this a full toss just so that way all of the butter fully incorporates into the juices of the apples and you're going to be left with this really beautiful base. Give this one last taste and mine needed just a touch more lemon juice to bring out some tartness from those apples. Give it one final toss, making sure all of those juices are fully incorporated. You don't want a large pool of liquid with these apples. Place this into your container of choice to fully cool down, making sure that these apples don't continue to cook for too long. I did place these into the fridge after about 10 minutes. And now another garnish we have to make for the matcha French toast is actually some fried peanuts. Place around 80 grams worth of skin-on peanuts into your container of choice and fill this with water. We are going to soak this for around 10 minutes. After those 10 minutes, all we need to do is strain these completely and make sure they are relatively dry since we are going to be adding this to oil. I like to make sure to dry these out completely. I place these on some paper towels, giving them a nice even flat layer and then rolling the paper towel up. So this way we dry those peanuts out as best as we can so we don't have any explosions of oil in the kitchen. Don't press down too hard on the paper towel, otherwise you'll just crush your peanuts. Now place all of your peanuts into cold oil. You want to make sure that these are fully submerged in that oil. Bring this over to your stove and start bringing this up over a medium-high heat. The goal is to bring this up to 350 degrees Fahrenheit over around a 10-minute period. This will start to fry up relatively quickly and make sure you do not let any of those sit at the bottom because they will burn on the bottom of that pan. And just like the brown butter, we let these go for just about 20 seconds too long and they will immediately burn on you, so make sure you do pay attention to this. You do not want to serve these peanuts. I ended up frying a second batch and I pulled them just before they really started to get any kind of golden brown color. This way it will carry over just a small amount as they are cooling down. Place this onto some paper towels to fully dry off and remove any excess oil. Once you've tossed these for around 2 minutes, remove the paper towel and generously season this with a bunch of salt and just a pinch of sugar. This is going to give it a nice balance of sweetness and saltiness. After tossing it with salt and sugar, place it on your cutting board and give this a rough chop. You don't want to pulverize the peanuts and turn it into dust. You want some nice chunky bits in there along with some smaller parts as well. After giving it a rough chop, place it back into your bowl with the remaining salt and sugar that was on the bowl. Give it a quick toss and place this into your container of choice. And these might still be warm, so make sure you don't put a lid on this immediately. Let it hang out at room temperature until they are totally cooled down. Now the next part is super easy. Just take 3 to 4 eggs and crack these into your plate or bowl of choice. Add it around 75 milliliters worth of heavy cream and just make sure the eggs are totally broken down into a nice smooth consistency for your French toast batter. You want to make sure that these are broken down, otherwise you're going to have weird bits of eggs in your French toast. Place this over to the side and grab the bread that you're deciding to use. And in my case, I'm using some local shokupan. If you want to make your own shokupan, check out the Fisherman's Toast video below. We're also going to need some mochi ice cream for this, and in particular, matcha mochi. Pull out 2 pieces from the freezer and set them to the side while you trim off the crusts off of your shokupan. Make sure you try to keep these as even as possible, and once you have these all nicely cut, take all of those scraps and place it into a container to dry out for breadcrumbs. Now on each slice of your toast, we're going to spread out just a small amount of peanut butter. You want to try to go edge to edge with this on your toast, so this way it does a full complete seal when we add the mochi to it and you don't have any weird air gaps. Now after your mochi has sat out, you can roll these out, and that's the goal with this. You want to make sure you roll these out into these small half inch thick discs. Place this into the middle of one of your pieces of bread with peanut butter and place a second piece of bread with peanut butter right on top of it, pressing down to complete that seal. I decided I was going to do 2 slices of this French toast rather than do a triple decker, so I grabbed another piece of shokupan and made sure I trimmed it up accordingly and added peanut butter to both of those sides of toast as well. Once I had the peanut butter on that, I rolled out my second piece of mochi, placing it in the middle, placing the top down onto that mochi and pressing down slightly to create that seal. Once I had those seals nice and tight, place this onto a plate and into the freezer for about 10 minutes until we're ready to use it. While those are hanging out in the freezer, I wanted to make sure that my caramel was ready to use for my apple pie. Take a small amount of your caramel and place it into a squeeze bottle. The reason why I'm going with the squeeze bottle is so it does look nicer on the plate later, but feel free to just place this into a bowl to warm up and you could just drop caramel on top of anything that you're working on. Once you have the caramel in, throw the lid on it and place this into some hot water until we're ready to use it. Now my French toast is going to be battered and placed onto a griddle, so I want to make sure I cook these off first. After placing these in the batter and throwing them onto the grill, this is when I hit it with a small spice blend of cinnamon, nutmeg, and clove. You just need equal parts of each, and we're just doing a small pinch on this rather than putting it into the batter. While those are cooking, take half of your apples and place them in the microwave for about a minute just to warm them up. Give these a nice flip after 2 to 3 minutes, and then flip them one more time after an additional 2 minutes, and we're going to place this on a wired oven rack. This is going to go in the toaster oven to finish cooking off, but first, we need to place those now warmed apples right on top of our pieces of toast. I went slightly heavier on one piece of toast with my apples, so this would act as the top piece of your French toast. I did end up pulling a small portion of the other apples out of the fridge and just placing it on top of that second piece because I feel like it needed some more. Now generously coat both pieces of French toast with your apple pie crumble. I wanted to try to seal these off with the crumble, and then bake this off at 375 degrees for around 7 minutes until you get some nice color on that crumble. Now, while the apple pie French toast is working in the toaster oven, we're going to batter and fry up the other matcha mochi French toast. You want to make sure that when you drop this in your batter, you do coat the sides completely, because that is where the seals are going to be when we drop this in the deep fryer. Now, drop this in your fryer at 300 degrees Fahrenheit, making sure that you do prod this just a small amount, so this way it does have full coverage of oil. You are going to need to flip this halfway through the cooking process, though, so keep that in mind. This won't fully submerge because it is frying bread and it is really buoyant. After around 2 to 3 minutes on each side, you should achieve some really nice golden brown color on that bread. After you get that really beautiful golden brown, remove it from the oil and place this on a cooling rack. Place the second piece of French toast into that oil and continue to cook that until that is also a beautiful golden brown. Remove it and place it onto your rack so we can get ready to plate this thing up. By now, your French toast a la mode should be ready and you have some nice color on that crumble and we can start plating up both portions. I even bought some brand new beautiful plates for you guys just to make sure that this looked as best as possible. Now take one slice of your apple pie a la mode and place that onto your plate. Then realize that your caramel is not hot enough, so you throw it in the microwave for 10 seconds and drizzle caramel directly over that first piece of French toast. Take the second piece of French toast and lay it over the top of it, making sure that it isn't directly on top so you have those nice angles going on. Now grab the other two matcha mochi French toasts and place that directly onto your plate. Then grab that matcha spread. You can see how much this has thickened up into this beautiful paste, and place two small dollops of it on top of your French toast. You want to make sure there's room in the middle for the ice cream. Speaking of ice cream, my homemade ice cream was in the refrigerator for around 30 minutes versus the ube, which did not need to be tempered. Take a nice hefty scoop of your ube ice cream, making sure it is as compact as possible, and place that in between the two dollops of matcha spread. The tempering of the ice cream is super important for this vanilla, so make sure you do that as well. Take a nice hefty scoop of your beautiful homemade vanilla ice cream and place this directly on top of your French toast. And now garnish the deep fried mochi ice cream French toast with a nice drizzle of honey just as your sauce. Garnish your apple pie a la mode French toast with a sexy amount of caramel, then a touch of crumble, and finish your matcha French toast with those toasted deep fried peanuts. And there it is, the French toast battle. Your beautiful apple pie French toast and your matcha mochi French toast.
And there it is, guys, the French toast battle for this month's Shokugeki. Now, I will say this looks absolutely phenomenal, especially with the deep fried and the ube on top. But then you have the apple pie a la mode French toast. I mean, look at both of these. I would be happy to have either one of these on the menu, not gonna lie, but we have an issue. While I was making these, Rachel got called out to a crime scene because yes, she's Batman, so you're left with me to try these. Now, I will say, anytime I'm making someone else's recipe, I really do put forth my best effort to really try to do it justice, so I hope that you guys are happy with how these came out. They both look phenomenal. We're just gonna dig into both of them. And in true Food Wars fashion, I'm gonna try mine first and then try the other one second. Just because, you know, the second one usually wins, so there we go. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna try Sage's French toast first because I know these have been sitting for just a few minutes. You can see the ice cream is melting a little bit, but I wanna make sure that I eat this while this is warm and then I'll dive into mine after. What I'm gonna try to do, I'm gonna try the French toast by itself. Ooh, the mochi. Oh my God, look, hold on, before I try this, look at this. Focus, camera, focus, the mochi is oozing out of the center. Ooh, that makes me excited. Hold on. Cheers. It's actually really airy and really light. I was worried it was gonna be overly greasy. Man, look at that. That's so cool looking. Now look at the ube is starting to intermingle with the green tea. It looks really cool. Come on. Okay, let's try it with some of the mochi, matcha, everything together. We'll get some of the ube on there as well. The honey itself more or less integrated with the matcha and the ice cream at this point. So here's a little bit of everything. Oh, that's so good. The matcha is super earthy. And then you have a light sweetness. It's not overly sweet, but it's also not dry. This is really nice. We can get a center cut maybe. At this point, the ube is starting to melt, but I want you to see the layers. Here's the layers of that. Look at how beautiful that looks. Oh, and there's the peanut butter flavor. Oh my God, this is phenomenal. And then you have some of the chewiness of the mochi. This is delicious. This is really good. Who am I gonna give this to? Do I have a neighbor I can give this to? Okay, let's try the apple pie a la mode French toast. Now, again, I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm gonna try just the French toast without really any ice cream or anything like that. I wanna see if I captured that apple pie flavor. Really what I was thinking of when I was making this is McDonald's apple pie fritters that they used to have, right? The spices are just enough to not be overwhelming. And then the caramel, you taste a little bit of nuttiness from that brown butter. Then you have the beautiful creaminess of that homemade ice cream. This tastes like a really elevated McDonald's apple pie a la mode, which they should totally bring back. I don't know if they still have it. I haven't been in years. I'm gonna have a sugar high. We're gonna get some with the ice cream now. Oh my God. I'm supposed to be working with a trainer next year, which is, I guess, today. Oh my God, Happy New Year. Cheers. This is so good too. I don't know which one I would order. Nope, no more. Oh my God. I wish I had someone to share this with. This is unfortunate. Both of these absolutely are amazing, and I love the ideas behind this one, and I love the flavors behind this one. And they both taste so good, I would be happy ordering either one, to be honest. I'm just really sad no one is here to experience this because I'm home alone and Rachel's being Batman and I got cats. So in true epic rap battles of history fashion, let me know who won. You decide however they do it. If you guys want to submit your very own recipe, check out my website and the links down below on how you can do that. This series is sponsored by all the new merch we have, so if you want to check that out, I would really appreciate it. My name is Chef PK, get subscribed and remember, keep playing with your food. And congratulations, Sage. This is a phenomenal recipe. Absolutely delicious. I don't know what I'm gonna do with both of these. Gandalf.